Hey, good evening. If you would stand with us tonight, we're going to open up with Lord, I Need You.
Lord, I come, I confess, Thou in Thee I find my rest. Without You, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need You, oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need You. Where sin runs deep, Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where You are. And where You are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Yes, where You are, Lord, is Christ in me. Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need. To rise to You when temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on You. Jesus, You're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on You. Jesus, You're my hope and stay. Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need You.
One more time.
Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. Every hour I need You. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need You. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I
thank you, ladies, for that. Enjoy that. Let me see if I can make a statement that if you can relate with it or not. The Lord does not need me, but I desperately need Him. Can anybody else relate to that? He doesn't need us, and He's gotten by a long, long time without us, and He'll get by when we're gone from this place, but we desperately need God. Amen. Can you imagine a day without God in your life? Thankfully, we don't have to imagine that. Amen. Because it'll never take place. Would you please bow your heads and hearts and join me in prayer? Father, we thank you so very much, God, just for the God for the truth that song brings us, Lord God. We need you, dear God. God, not just on Sundays, not just when things are going bad, not when things are going well, but we need you all times and all places, dear God. And we are so grateful, God, that you, God, just you are so, that your presence is so vast. You cover the whole world. You got the whole world in your hands, dear God. So thank you so very much, God. It's a blessing to know, God, that God, you are never too busy, God, just to be with just the, God, just the dearest of your saints. So thank you for being with this church tonight. May you bless our service, dear God. I thank you, God, for our time this morning. And God, I pray that that time would really change our lives. And God, once again, we invite you, God, just to saturate this place with your presence tonight, dear God, and just make the difference in our lives. Lord God, just as the song says, we need you. And we thank you for your presence, God. Thank you for how you bless. And we pray this believing because we ask it in Jesus' name. And if you can agree with that prayer, help me say amen. Amen. Please be seated. A few things that I did not share with you this morning, and that is this this coming Saturday, we're going to have our summer bash here at the church. Normally, we try to do it in August, but it just got pushed to September. So this Saturday will be our summer bash. We actually have some sign-up sheets out there at the information booth. So if you can sign up tonight and also Wednesday. I know it's kind of a last-minute, you know, petition for help, but just, you know, with the busyness of everybody's scheduling, me and Bill talked about maybe just postponing it, but we thought, you know, it's best that since everybody's just really been grinding a whole lot and working so much the past couple of weeks that it would be great to offer the summer bash to families at our church. Families in our community can come out and just relax and have a great time and turn their kids loose on the water slides, okay? So we need to help with that. Their sign-up sheet is out there. We need people to set up, to man the booths and to tear down generators. We need some generators if you can help us with that. You'll see all the needs that are out there on that sign-up sheet. You've helped us with that. Also, the annual meeting. You know, we're in a part of the Northeast Florida Baptist Association, and they are trying something different. They, for a long, long time, 40-plus years, they have did a semi-annual meeting and an annual meeting, but just the attendance has really kind of dwindled down at each of them. So they're thinking, their logic is, let's try just one a year. So they're talking about doing away with the semi-annual and just doing one a year, and it's the annual. And so this year, it's October the 8th, and it's going to take place at First Baptist Church Hilliard, and that is on a Sunday night. So they're asking, you know, many churches don't even have service on Sunday night, so they're asking the ones like us if we would just move our services to Sunday evening. So we're going to do that this year. And so at First Baptist Hilliard, we're going to leave here at 4 o'clock and take the bus. So if you just want to drive here, we can ride the bus out there. But this is in your bulletin, so you can get a glimpse of that as a reminder for that. And also, last but not least, it's that time of year again where we start trying to push for our officers for next year. So if you would, also out there in the foyer area is our Christian worker survey sheets. And also this year, we've also actually went over this thing, and so we put an asterisk beside, you know, the positions that need the most attention. You know, it's not that all the other areas are staffed and they have all the people they need. That's not what we're saying. But if you notice an area with an asterisk beside it, that just shows you that we could really use the help in those areas. So we've actually extended the deadline on these because of the cancellation of services and just trying to get back to normal. So if you could take one of these, pray over the selection process of where you want to help work at in the church for this coming year of 2018. And if you can, fill it out, sign it, and just you can turn it in, just put it in the offering bags and receive the offering, and so we'll get them collected that way. All right. Miss Cheryl, is she back there yet? Are they ready is the main thing. Okay. All right, so good things come to those who wait, so y'all wait just a little bit longer, okay? We have the kids' choir is going to sing for us tonight. They've been working for a long, long time, and so we get to see them present to us some of their songs tonight. Y'all help welcome the kids' choir. Church family, help me give the round of applause one more time for our kids' choir. Amen. At this time, would you please leap to your feet and go greet your neighbor tonight? Thank you.
As we return to our seats, let's sing Sunshine in My Soul. There is sunshine in my soul today, more glorious and bright than glows in any earthly sky. For Jesus is my light. Oh, the sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. There is music in my soul today, a carol to my King. And Jesus listening can hear the songs I cannot sing. Oh, the sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. There is gladness in my soul today, and hope and praise and love for blessings which he gives me now, for joys laid up above. Oh, there's sunshine, blessed sunshine, when the peaceful, happy moments roll. When Jesus shows his smiling face, there is sunshine in my soul. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to sing, I Need Thee Every Hour. This will be our offertory hymn. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to gather in your house tonight, Lord, and just to hear your word, Lord, and just to sing your praises. Father, we just pray that we never forget to sing praises and thank you for everything you've done. Lord, we ask now that you be with this service tonight. Father, we pray if there's anyone under this roof that doesn't know you as their personal Savior tonight, they'll make the greatest decision they could ever make. And Father, we just want to lift up all those hurting, all those sick tonight, Lord, and all those in the hospitals throughout this world. We just pray that you just pour out your healing mercies upon them. Father, as we take up this offering, we ask that it be used just for your kingdom throughout this world. For all these things, we ask your heavenly name. Amen. Thank you.
Appreciate your orchestra. Sounds good as always. At this time, if you take a copy of God's Word and turn to, I don't know because I'm not preaching tonight, but you'll find out in just a few seconds, okay? Brother Steve Zurcher is going to come. Am I pronouncing your last name right, I hope? Zurcher? Okay, if I'm not, he'll correct me when he comes up here. But nevertheless, we are blessed, you know, by the ministry, Brother Steve. They just recently moved to our area. He'll probably share a little bit of that. But been in the ministry 40-plus years, you know, no lie, he's probably forgotten more than I'll ever know. So I'm looking forward to hearing him bless us tonight with the spoken word of God. So church family, help me welcome Brother Steve to the platform tonight.
Pastor, you can call me anything you want as long as you don't call me late for dinner. My last name is Zurcher. The C-H is pronounced like a K. But I've answered to a lot of things. When I was a missionary in Haiti, the people had a problem with that E-R and U-R sound. And I had one friend who called me Pastor Zekle. And Pierre will appreciate that. That's Pastor Lightning. And that's because I was so quick. I'm honored to be here tonight. It's been my experience that Baptist pastors do not easily invite someone who has never been a part of a Baptist church to speak in their pulpit, and even more especially when you've never heard them preach before. So I appreciate the leap of faith that you've taken tonight. I don't know, maybe he's got a suitcase packed in case I crash and burn. But it is an honor to be here. I'm a missionary kid, my background. My parents went to Haiti as missionaries when I was 11 years old, and so I grew up there. And later, after college and marriage, my wife and I went back to Haiti and were missionaries there for 10 years. And then after that, we ended up in Hawaii, which we'd never expected. But we were out there, and I pastored the same church for 25 years. And it was on a Hawaiian homestead. So everybody in the church, except for me and my wife and our family, had a large percentage of Hawaiian blood. And that was okay, because after a short time, they forgot how pale our skin was. And we became one of them, and loved our time there. The last 10 years, I was not only pastor of the church, but also the district superintendent for our 16 churches on three islands out there. So that's kind of a little bit of my background. I was 45 years in the ministry, and then retired in February of this year. In March, the Lord said, "You've suffered enough in Hawaii. I'm going to send you to Florida so you can meet Irma." So, you know, Hawaii usually has hurricanes on average once every 10 years. The last hurricane they had there was in 92, the year before we moved there. So we were there for 25 years, never had a hurricane. Then I come to Florida, and I'm not even here 6 months, and you guys treat me to one already. So I don't know how that's going to go. But after we were here for about 3 weeks, a lady who works at the Wells Fargo Bank here in Yulee, I don't know if she's a manager or assistant manager, she was talking to my son, and she recommended your church to us. And so we came and immediately felt welcome and at home, and we appreciate that so much. We haven't gone anywhere else since. And we love your pastor. Love his messages, appreciate his sense of humor. I think that if you lose your sense of humor, you need to just dig a hole and climb in. So I appreciate that very much. And we want to thank you for the welcome that you have given us. I probably won't start every point of my message with the same letter like your pastor does. I think that must be part of the Baptist doctrine I never heard about. But that's good. Speaking of retirement, I heard about a pastor and his wife who, they were just starting out their ministry, actually, moved into their first home for their pastorate, and the wife pointed to a drawer in the dresser, and she told her husband, she says, "Now that's my drawer. I don't want you to ever go in there. Don't open it. Don't go into that drawer." You know, well, that's kind of strange, but he honored her request, and all the years they were there, he never opened the drawer. And each time they moved to a different church, she would always pick out a drawer, and she'd say, "Now that's my drawer. You keep out of that drawer. Don't open it." And so that happened time and time again. And all the time he was in ministry, he never violated that. Finally, the day came for him to preach his last sermon at the church and to retire. And they got home, and she says, "Okay, you can go look in the drawer now." So he opened the drawer, and in the drawer were 3 eggs and $5,000. He says, "Well, what's this about?" He said, what are the eggs?" She says, "Well, every time that you preached a bad sermon, I put an egg in the drawer." You know, wow, that's pretty good. You know, all these years I've been preaching, only 3 bad sermons. So he says, "Well, what about the $5,000? She says, "Well, every time I got a dozen, I sold them." If you have your Bibles and you can stand, would you turn to Matthew chapter 21? And we're going to read just a few verses of that chapter, beginning in verse 28. Matthew 21, verse 28, the parable of the 2 sons. "But what do you think?" Jesus asked. "A man had 2 sons, and he came to the first and said, 'Son, go work today in my vineyard.' He answered and said, 'I will not.' But afterward he regretted it and went. Then he came to the second and said likewise. And he answered and said, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the 2 did the will of his father?" They, that would be the religious leaders, said to him, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you, that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But tax collectors and harlots believed him, and when you saw it, you did not afterward relent and believe him." May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may be seated. Two sons. Neither one had a whole lot to commend them. The first one was rude. "No, I won't go." And the second, although he had nice words to say, said the right words, he was disobedient and didn't go. Now, I have to tell you that in the home that I grew up in, that first son didn't exist, at least not for very long. My father did not beat us, but we got our share of spankings, and he had lots of ways to make you regret talking back. And I don't think that ever would have happened. He would not have told us to go do something, and we would have just stood up and said, "I will not." We would have regretted that greatly. But I can identify with a second son. There was more than one time when Dad said, I'm going somewhere. I need you to do this while I'm gone." And my brother, who's just about the same age as I am, he's just a little over a year and a half younger, we'd say, "Okay, yeah, we got it. And then we'd go about playing our games or doing whatever, and we'd kind of forget about it until suddenly it was too late and Dad was pulling in the driveway or walking up to the front door. And it wasn't done. Can you identify with that? Yeah, a few of you can. Some of you aren't honest, but that's a... The difference between the two sons was that the first had a change of heart and a change of behavior. We have a good theological term for that. It's actually a term in the Bible. It's called repentance. Ever heard of that? Yeah. He repented. Jesus pointed to the religious leaders and said, "You heard John's message of repentance and the kingdom of God being at hand, and you didn't obey. And essentially what he told them was, thieves and sexual predators have a better chance of getting into the kingdom than you do. Now that's not very nice, not very politically correct, but it was correct. Because at least those people had repented and changed their behavior. And Jesus went on and told in that chapter a second parable about the wicked tenants. And it says when he was done with these two parables that the religious leaders perceived that he was talking about them. Duh. Yeah. And they didn't like it. What application would Jesus make for us of this parable today? The father told his sons, both of them, go and work in my vineyard. What would we, or what should we be doing to be doing the will of the Father? Now, Pastor John preached from Romans 12 not long ago, the first couple of verses, and he told us that God's will is not a mystery. Right? Where do we find God's will? Right here in Scripture. He's told us what his will is. Jesus told us, love God supremely. Right? Love others like yourself. Those are commands that deal with our heart and the behavior that flows out of that. Love is an active verb in the Bible. You can't be like the lady in my first pastorate who was mad at the mailman because he delivered her mail to her neighbor two different times. And she said to me one Sunday, she says, I love everybody, but I can't stand that mailman. That's not how it works. Love God supremely. Love others as yourself. And then he gave the church one job to do, just like he gave those sons in the parable. You know what it is? Go and make, come on, you can finish it now, disciples. That really is the task that Jesus left for us. Go and work in my vineyard. Go and make disciples. We're to make disciples. We're to baptize them, bring them into the fellowship of the church, and we're to teach them to observe all that he has commanded us to do. That's making a disciple. And he told us to go and do that. Now, we have to remember that he gave us that command after his resurrection. By then, the disciples knew this was the Messiah. This was the Son of God. He had conquered death. He had risen from the grave. Secondly, he starts out by reminding them, all authority is given to me in heaven and in earth. You ever had to go talk to somebody on behalf of your boss? I'm not talking about your wife or your husband. I'm talking about, you know, the boss where you work. And you go and you have to tell them something and they kind of look at you like, who are you? And then you say, so-and-so sent me. Pastor John told me to tell you. Makes all the difference in the world. Because Pastor John's authority is backing up my words. I am going in his authority to speak to this person. And Jesus told his disciples, when you go and make disciples, you're not going on your own authority. You're not going all by yourself with no backing. You're going with the person who has all authority in heaven and earth. And then he promises them his presence. He ends up by saying, and lo, I am with you No, not to, just till Wednesday. Thursday, you don't make disciples. Just till Wednesday. No. Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. We call it the Great Commission. Well, actually not. Many places in the church today, we call it the Great Suggestion. Yeah? The Great Suggestion. The first church took it seriously. Now, God had to kind of prompt them to get out of their pew. You remember he sent persecution to Jerusalem and that scattered them. But everywhere that they went, they were making disciples. I'll tell you with confidence, it was not just the 12 apostles who spread the gospel. These people, everywhere they went, they're telling people about this person who had come to earth from God and who had died and who had risen from the dead and who had changed their lives and who had saved them from their sin. They went out and they fulfilled it. They were faithful in making disciples. And they were fruitful. How'd I do, Pastor? They were faithful. And they were fruitful. And within a very short time, the gospel had permeated the whole known world at that time. They went everywhere telling the gospel. So how are we doing? Well, there's a recent Barna report. You know who Barna is, George Barna? He's kind of the poll taker for the Christian church. He's written a number of books and put out a number of polls. One of his recent reports tells us this, that in a recent 10-year period, the church spent $500 billion with no growth to show for it. The institutional church spent $1.5 million for each new convert that they reported. That it took 85 church members 1 year to win one convert. Now, I'm not big on statistics, but when I heard those, that was crushing. That was a condemnation of the church in America today. The number of adults no longer attending church has almost doubled since 1991. From 39 million to 79 million dropouts, while the population itself has grown 15%. That's the bad news. That's the horrible news. And it tells us that the church, by and large, has lost its vision and has lost its sense of urgency to fulfill the Great Commission that God gave us. There are many, many Christians in the church today who in their whole life will never lead another person to Christ. Oswald J. Smith said, any church that is not making disciples has no right to exist. Because it is a command. The good news is, and there is some good news, that more and more Christians are taking the Great Commission seriously. I know that some of you do, and you are to be commended. We have a conference center in Keystone, South Dakota, where we bring pastors and church leaders from around the world twice a year for a conference to help them refocus their ministry on making disciples that make disciples and launching disciple-making movements. Pastors who are so busy with programs, with buildings, with administration that they have forgotten that Jesus said, I will build my church. You go and make disciples. And they come to these conferences and God breaks their heart and they repent in tears. And they have gone back with a determination that they are going to make disciples. Sadly, some of them go back to their countries and to their churches and they try to do that and the church says, no, we don't operate that way. You can't do that here. And some of them have given up their church, given up their salaries, their homes, their cars, their position, and launched out because they said, we have got to do this. This is the command of Christ to make disciples. And some of them in the last couple of years have lost their lives because of their obedience to the Great Commission. What is a disciple? And how do we make one? Very simply, a disciple is a devoted follower of Jesus Christ. A devoted follower of Jesus Christ. Now, how many verses in the Bible do you need to know to make a disciple? Anybody know? You're all right. None. Now, it's great if you do. There's nothing bad about knowing Scripture and being able to quote it. But you don't have to know a single verse of Scripture. You don't have to know the four spiritual laws. I don't know, does the Baptist Church have something similar to that that you learn? You don't have to know any of that stuff. What do you need to know to make a disciple? Can you tell me? What about Jesus? Who's this guy? What do I need to know about him? All you need to know is he saved me and he can save you. He met my need. He can meet yours. In Hawaii, we have a phrase that we use all the time. We say, talk story. When we sit down and we have a conversation, we talk story. And you're telling me your story and I'm telling you mine. We all did that after Hurricane Irma. We all came back to church. Everybody was talking story. How'd you manage? What happened at your house? Here's what happened to me. Some of you tonight are saying, man, I'm exhausted from all the cleanup. We're talking story. That's how you make disciples. By talking story. By building relationship and telling people what Jesus has done for you. The Bible says that when you use Scripture, God's Holy Spirit uses it to accomplish what He will. So there is value in quoting Scripture. But let me tell you, your testimony has tremendous impact on other people. Some people don't know, sad to say, in society, in our society today, people don't know the Bible. They don't even know what it is. We had a missionary in France, this wasn't in America, but it was in France, in Paris, who went to a dormitory of a university and asked the guys, do you know who Jesus is? And one of the guys says, I think he lives on the second floor. Now, we laugh at that, but you can get that kind of answer in America today. You know? So, Scripture is great, and I have a very high regard for Scripture. But your testimony is invaluable. It's like the man who was made to see. He said, I don't know. All I know is I couldn't see, now I can see. And that's what Jesus did for me, and that's what he can do for you. And that's how we make disciples, build relationships. I want to tell you about a friend of mine in Haiti. His name is George. Everybody calls him Uncle George. And in Hawaii, if you're older than the other person, you're always uncle or auntie. Unless you're a pastor, then you're either pastor or kahu. That's why I can't just call you John. You're either Pastor John or you're going to be Kahu John. And Melissa would either be auntie, or they might also call her Kahu, or they might call her the First Lady. You know, you want to feel important, go to Hawaii. Uncle George. We were going to have a seminar at our church to help people focus, to cast vision to people for making disciples who make disciples. And I encouraged him to come. And he looked at me kind of funny, and he says, "I'm happy where I am." He said, "I don't want to go to Africa or someplace like that." And I'm thinking, wow, there's a disconnect here. You know? And I said, "George, you don't have to go to Africa to make a disciple. You make a disciple anywhere you are." So he came to the seminar, and God really challenged his heart. And he was praying about how he could connect with people and make disciples. Now, George loves to stand-up paddleboard. Any of you do stand-up paddleboarding? A lot of you out there my age, you're not going to try it anymore. But taking a surfboard out on the ocean with a paddle and paddling around on the waves. And George loves to do that. And one day, he's sitting down at the beach with his paddleboard, and he sees this lady and her daughter and husband. And they were out paddleboarding, but they only had one board. And so they had to take turns. The dad would go out with the little girl and come back in, and then the mother would go out. So George says, "Hey," he says, "take my board. Both of you go out with your daughter." And so they hopped on his board, and they all went out, had a great time in the bay, Pokai Bay there on our side of the coast. And they came back, and George didn't think much of it until a couple days later, the mother and the daughter were back at the bay again. And she came up to him, and she says, "Thank you so much." She said, "My husband was about to be deployed. This was our last weekend together as a family. And you made it special because you let us use your paddleboard." And a light went on in George's head, and he realized that here was his passion, and he could use it for ministry. And so George started giving paddleboard lessons down at the bay for free. Now, that's significant because in Hawaii, if you want a paddleboard lesson, you usually pay somewhere between $50 to $100. He started giving stand-up paddleboard lessons for free. Anybody wanted to come down? Started out with two boards. As friends recognized his ministry and wanted to help, and sometimes people who had been taught by him later on came back, they gave him more and more boards. George today has over 30 boards. And George has taught over 6,000 people to stand up paddleboard. Now, you got to understand, Pokai Bay is this little bay way out on the west side of Oahu. It's not in Waikiki. It's not where you would think a lot of people come. But George has taught people to paddleboard from all over the world, and many local people. And the only caveat is you don't pay, but you got to sit and listen to his story before he teaches you how to stand up paddleboard. And then they go out and they enjoy the bay with the paddleboards, and after a while they get tired and they come back in and they sit down and they talk story with Uncle George. And George has baptized people. He's married people. You know, in Hawaii you can do that. You can sign up, just about anybody can sign up with the Department of Health and marry somebody. He's had marriages. And then he started a group on Facebook called Prayer Warriors. And anybody who went through his training or made his acquaintance, they were welcome to sign up in this group called Prayer Warriors. And if they had a prayer request or a need, they could post it on Facebook. And people from around the world at different times, you know, are praying for this need. He now has hundreds of people signed up for his group of prayer warriors. And many of them, even though they're a long ways away, he talks to them on the phone, he emails them, he has a ministry with them, he has a connection with them. And he has been able to make disciples through this ministry, which was just employing his passion, the thing that he loved to do. What is your passion? What is your sphere of influence? Who do you have relationships with? Who do you talk story with? Make disciples. Be intentional. Pray about it. You know, it's amazing what prayer does. Don't you know? It's just absolutely amazing. You pray and ask God to bring people into your life that he wants you to disciple, and he'll do it. He has people out there prepared tonight for you to disciple if you're willing to be obedient. And anybody can do it. My friend's church, just a couple miles down the road, had a gal in the church who was mentally challenged. Not severely, but a little bit mentally challenged. And she came to one of those seminars where we were talking about making disciples. And she got all excited. And you know what she did? She went to school and she found a friend. And she asked the friend to come and sit down with her. And they go through the daily bread every day together. And she's discipling her friend. When I left Hawaii, I was meeting once a week with two guys. Both of them, one's a former drug addict, one's still an addict. Who was sitting down with him once a week to do Bible study. The one who's a former addict I had worked with for a time, he's been drug-free for almost 2 years now. He's the one that brought the other fellow. So a disciple who made a disciple and brought him to a Bible study. Jesus said, if you abide in me and I abide in you, you will bring forth much fruit. And the fruit that he's talking about, folks, is not the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is what the Spirit does. Jesus wants you to bear fruit. Now, if I plant a peach tree, I don't expect to get an apple from it. If I plant a peach tree, I expect to get peaches from it. And the same thing is true when Jesus says to you, go and make disciples, that you will have fruit. He expects your fruit to look like you. And they will. If you're not walking very well with the Lord, probably they won't be either. So there's some responsibility that goes with it. Find your passion, identify your sphere of influence, and be intentional in building relationships and talking stories. Share that Christ has met your needs, that he has been your companion in times of loneliness, that he has given you confidence in times of uncertainty, and that he has given you certainty of your purpose and direction in life. There you go, three C's. I'm getting the hang of it. I've only been here since toward the end of March. And I'm not a perfect example, but I want you to know that I've been intentional. I have gotten acquainted with every one of my neighbors. I know their names, the ones immediately around me, and for the most part, that second circle of neighbors. Every chance I get, I'm telling them that I'm praying for them. I tell them that I'm praying for our circumstances. Irma was a great opportunity. You know, well, I don't know what's going to happen. Well, we'll pray about it and trust God. Now, I didn't give them the four spiritual laws. I haven't led any of them to Christ yet. But I'm planting seeds and building relationships. And there's going to come a day when I can make disciples of some of those people. But it doesn't just happen. You have to be intentional about it and believe that that's what God has called you to do. I like the pastor's note in the bulletin this morning. He ends up by saying, ready, set, go. God bless you as you obey the Great Commission.
Thank you, Brother Zerker, for that message. Also, thank you for that. Thank you for the reminder of how important it is. And the great commandment, the Great Commission, has been called the Great Commission because, you know what? It's great, okay? And there's nothing subpar about it. It's great because Jesus mandated that to all of us. So here's how I want to summarize this in my mind. Thank you for the illustration about George, by the way, Uncle George. That really, it's very practical to me to understand that. So here's my statement. There's a little bit of George in most of us, but a lot of George in a lot of us. And what I mean by that is, for a long time, he made an excuse why he couldn't do ministry in his local place. And I think a lot of us, we have made excuses that Jesus has just not signed off on. Does that make sense? You know, just like George, we all have made excuses. Well, I'm looking for that great big opportunity to get on an airplane and fly over to Ecuador. Then I can be on mission. No. You know, we are on mission right here and right now. So we have got to come to a place where we stop making excuses and understand that missions is not something we go out there and do. Every day God opens our eyes, we're on mission. So listen, I'm not saying you guys, I'm saying we need to stop making excuses that Jesus has not signed off on. And so, you know, just like Uncle George, God can use us right where we are with what we have. Okay, think about your passions to this point, Brother Steve's point. Think about your passions. Think about where you are. Think about what you have, the resources you have, the knowledge and the information you have. God can use you right now. You don't have to go off to seminary and get a degree. Then God will use you. No, God will use you right where you are. You know, if you know me, you know I love sports. And one thing I recognize about sports is in a lot of sports, they have some intermission periods, whether it's called the seventh inning stretch or halftime. But I remember back in our football days when we went into halftime playing football, if you was way behind, you know, the coach would just say, hey, here's what we're going to do. We're going to throw the game plan out the window, and we're going to change it up. We got to try to get back in this game and win the ball game, okay? I don't know how you felt about those stats that he read off, but it seems to me like the scoreboard is not in our favor, where the church has not really gaining ground like we should. Spending millions and billions of dollars in programs and advertising, but yet we're not making a dent in darkness. So it's almost as if, you know, the scoreboard is not really in our favor. So here's what I learned about sports. When you go in at halftime, if you're down, you got two choices. You can just give up, say, well, we went and lost this one. Let's not even go back out there on the field. Let's just throw in the towel. Here's what I want you to hear tonight, church. If we just lay down and quit and wait for the rapture to come, we will not change the scoreboard. If we just quit, we will not reach our neighbor. If we just quit, we'll not reach our coworkers. If we just lay down and quit and just wait for the rapture to take place, we will not reach our family members. But if we take the commandment from God's word, and please understand me, whenever God gives us a commandment, he always gives us the ability to obey his commandment. God wants us so much to obey him that he gives us what we need to obey him. Does that make sense? Yesterday, I told my oldest son, I want you to drive over to Ocean Way, pick it. We was having these chairs recovered up here. I want you to take my car, go to Ocean Way, pick them up. Okay? And now what if I just told him, I want you to walk down to Ocean Way, pick up them two chairs and bring them back home? Listen, that wouldn't have worked. So I gave him my car. I gave him a command, but I also gave him the ability to obey what I commanded him to do. And if me as an earthly father operates that way, how much more does our heavenly father operate that way? He's not going to give us command, then have us stand in heaven one day and hold us accountable for something he never gave us the ability to obey. So I promise you, none of us are off the hook. You may never stand but find a platform and preach a message, but none of us are off the hook. It is not just the responsibility of some, but the responsibility of all to go and make disciples. So I challenge you. Listen, I don't have to add anything to Brother Steve's message tonight, but I'm just saying this as we prepare to dismiss tonight. I challenge you. I don't got to give you a new commandment. I don't have to give you a new commandment. Jesus has given us the great commandment. You don't improve upon perfection. You know, we cannot improve the great commandment. We're not to approve it. We're just to walk it out in obedience. Okay? So let's pray tonight. And I pray that you have been challenged as well as I have. Brother Richard, can you come lead us in a few verses tonight, please, if we can get our musicians ready on stage. Father God, thank you for our time together tonight. God, thank you for the clarity of your word. And God, I pray for the conviction of your word. God, we have been reminded tonight, dear God. And God, once again, it's not just that. It's not that we got to come and hear something brand new or to hear some theology come from a different angle. We just need to be reminded of something we know to do. And tonight, Brother Steve has reminded us from your word how important it is to be obedient to the great commandment. So God, thank you so very much for how you will bless. And God, I pray that, God, that we would just respond in obedience. And instead of making excuses, God, help us to look for the opportunities that you give us to take our personalities and our passions and use them for the glory of Jesus. Father, I love you and I bless you. In Christ's name, I pray, believing. And if you can agree with that, help me say amen. Hey, would you stand with me tonight? Maybe you prayed already while I was praying. Maybe you're praying through that sermon. But maybe you need to pray now. And so if there is a prayer to be prayed, a decision to be decided, would you come tonight? And if you just want to get along with the Lord, walk right on past me and just spend as much time as you need with God. But I'm going to be down front. If you would like for me to pray with you, I would love that opportunity. But don't delay whatever God is doing in your heart and life. Would you come tonight as we sing? Attention tonight, this morning, and tonight. And before we dismiss, I'm just reminded a number of years ago when I was still working at Toyota, a friend of mine, he was, you know, not much older than me, just a few years older than me. He was dying with brain cancer, and he left the job, left a great job, went to seminary to go into the ministry, and soon after that he was diagnosed with this brain cancer, and he went down so fast. But in his home, and you got to understand him, he loved Jesus without any question. And his words, this was probably 12 years ago or better. I'll never forget what he told me. He said this, that his only regret is that he could not stay here and continue to do more for Jesus. So that was his only regret. And to me, it instantly just struck a chord in my heart. And that is what I labeled a righteous regret. Most people in their life, they regret they didn't do enough for Jesus. But his only regret was he couldn't stay and do more for Jesus. So, friend, I want to encourage you tonight. I don't want you to get to that place in your life where you're 50, you're 60, and you get to 70, and you look back and you wasted 20 or 30 years, and you just wish that you would have done what God wanted you to do. For I encourage you to accept the calling that God has on your life and not wait until another opportunity arises down the road, but take what God gives you today, the resources and the ability He gives you, and use what He has given to you. And He has placed us here for a reason. You know, as we go, listen, we all got different vineyards to go out into. We all got different mission fields. So as you go to work tomorrow, as you go to school tomorrow, or as I go to the office or wherever I'm at tomorrow, let us be faithful until God calls us home. Amen. Hey, reach out to your neighbor. Thank you for coming. We'll sing our song of dismissal. May you have a blessed week, and Lord willing, we'll see you soon.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, for He is worthy to be praised and adored. So we lift up holy hands in one accord, singing, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.